Okay, understand the proof of the union. Okay, not really understand. Yeah, because I'm understanding of the proof of the unit lemma. Or maybe yeah, even the unit lemma itself. But I don't see why is it useful.
Okay, I'll come to it. I'll come to the use of Yone Dilemma.
Okay, not really usefulness, but okay, they talk about one functor from a category D to a category of C and the home functor also. Okay, I don't seem to see the link between those two. What is
means? Firstly, if you take it as a statement, so do you get the statement? So what's the statement of Yoneda's lemma? Yoneda's lemma, let me restate it. So it says that, suppose I take A to be a category. Of with small home sets, okay, and I take F to be a set valued functor, and I take an object, okay. Now it says that to give natural transformations to F, okay, this collection is in bijective correspondence with this. And what is it? What is it given by? If you take an A from FA, your natural transformation is nothing else but F dot A. Okay? Which means this is, if you remember the definition, this is F of F. Where? Okay, where A, because what do this mean? F is therefore home AX. Right? Furthermore, it says, furthermore, the first part is this. The second part is that the bijection are natural. Both F and F. It is not an arbitrary bijection that is sitting around. If you change A, the bijections also change accordingly. If you change F, the bijection changes accordingly. It's a natural bijection. So this is the, roughly speaking, this is the statement about Yoneda. Nothing else. But it is very strong. The immediate impulse is very, very strong. Why is it strong? It is giving you a complete characterization of the natural transformations from representable home functors to any functor. Not this, set valued functors. Okay? We will look into applications of this. So it is saying something about this category. The category of functors from A to 6. It is saying something about this category. Firstly, The representable home functors are very, very special objects there. Okay? And how special?
Let's see. I can produce this. And if I map, if I have a morphism from A to B of A op, it actually means it's a morphism from B to A of A. And then this gives the composition with F as a as a natural transformation. Yeah? It's from B to A.
But in this case, it's A to B.
That's an A op.
Mm-hmm. No, here now.
Yes.
Because of op.
Yes. So actually what I'm having is how is this happening? Suppose if I have a morphism from A to X, I am already given with this morphism in A, so I compose. So a morphism from here, composed with F. So G composed with F gives me GF here. Right?
So this gives me a functor. How is this functor? How is this functor?
Well, let's see. So, let's look into HOM. YA, YB. Okay? What is this? This is HOM. By my Yoneda, this is telling, this is in bijection with, this is F. This is where Yoneda comes. Okay?
Mm-hmm.
Which is actually
okay? So it is saying that Y is full and faithful.
So it's exactly a very good question when you started off with this. What is full and faithful? Okay? It's full and faithful means it's the bijections.
Mm-hmm.
So Y is full and faithful. Right?
Mm-hmm.
Further. So Y is full and faithful. So that means locally, A op is sitting inside this functor category,
say,
functors from A to Z. Right?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. What next? YA is equal to YB. So that means right?
Mm.
So it forces A must be equal to B. Yeah?
Mm-hmm.
Remember, this was an alternative symbol for all homomorphisms of this functor, right? Home functor, right?
Which symbol?
This symbol.
Mm-hmm.
This is the home functor symbol.
Yeah.
So this functor being equal forces that this has to be equal. Right?
Mm-hmm.
So that means Y is full faithful, and I write it again, Y is full faithful and injective on objects. Okay?
So what is the scenario? Locally, each bit looks exactly the same. And this is not clubbed, right? Any object is not clubbed. Any two things are not clubbed over here. So this is actually an embedding of categories. In fact, that is a
definition. A functor is an embedding of categories. If it is full, faithful, and injective on objects.
There's some way, I don't remember, I was mistaken. There's some way they explain faithful in terms of being injective.
Yes. So locally.
Mm.
These maps, each of these maps are
injective.
Injective.
Okay.
That's faithful.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
But then there you said something again about injective.
Injective on object.
On object now.
Yes.
Oh.
Yes. It could be, it's full and faithful, as I said, for between sets and cardinalities, cardinal numbers. All the sets of the same cardinal number are actually clubbed to that same cardinal.
Mm-hmm.
So it's not actually a full, faithful, and injective object. Right? So it's actually the card, taking card, it's a functor. But it is not, it's full and faithful, but it's not injective on objects.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah? But here it is injective on objects. So we can visualize this as locally, between any two objects, the scenario is exactly the same as in A.
Mm-hmm.
Right?
Mm-hmm.
And it's injective on objects, so it seems that the whole of the category A is sitting inside the category B. There could be many others. Right? There could be many others. So the first consequence is that every category is embedded inside a functor category. Inside, it perceives. Okay, I'll give this name. Inside the category of perceives. What is a sheaf, or what is a presheaf? Well, which are functors, set-valued functors. On its dual. So actually people actually call this something else. This is written as Y star. I'll say Y. If you replace A by A op, you get the same picture, right?
Mm-hmm.
So that's the Yoneda embedding. That's written with one. Sorry. A up. So that's A going to the other one. You know it's this is F composed. Okay?
So it's embedded inside its dual. Okay. Now, so what?
You said A is embedded inside its dual.
It's not its dual, it's a precious. So functors, set in category of functors, defined on the dual of A into sex. Okay? So it's embedded inside its category of precious. How good is this embedding? Well, we will do. We will. And in fact, this will be the starting point of your particular area. Okay? So how good is this? Firstly, we will show. So how good is this? So we will do this as we go.
So you are asking how good is this embedding?
Yes.
Embedding in that precious.
In its precious. Because we know, we have seen many such questions, right? For instance, every group is embedded inside its permutation.
But that is too big, too big, right? The permutation group.
Mm.
And you are just lost. The group is just lost inside it. Okay? So permutation representation doesn't really quite help in group theory.
Mm.
Okay? But suppose take the case of stone check compact. It is also big, but it's a dense embedding.
Hmm.
Right? It's a compact Hausdorff space in which the original Tikhonov of space is densely embedded. Okay? So in some sense it is nice, right? So it's compact very nicely there. Naturally, such questions about how good this embedding is a very, very natural thing, right? We will show that every F is a colimit of representable. That means
functors.
Representables means this. That is functors like it's a colimit of a diagram.
Mm.
We have not come to it, so that's right.
Yeah.
So you can say something like that, right? You take any set valued functor. You take any set valued functor on A of, you can actually get it as a colimit. Colimit, what is a colimit? You will show that it is something like a push out and co-equalizer, a mixture of them. Okay? So it is something like, and what is a push out? It's again so it's something like a co-product and a co-equalizer, some mixture of them, right?
Mm-hmm.
Okay? So as if it is the colimit completion. Everything is the colimit, right?
Mm-hmm.
So as if I'm trying to say, is it the colimit completion? Is it the best with this?
Yes, it is. So, in what sense? And suppose you have any small, complete, small, co-complete category. Okay? And you have a functor, any functor, then there exists a unique functor. Okay? So, firstly, from which makes this diagram to commute.
Mm.
So it is kind of saying that this, if the codomain is co-complete, you can extend it. Says it's a similar picture like beta x, right?
Mm.
Right?
Mm.
It's a similar picture. So every functor to a small co-complete category gets extended to the category of pre-sheaves. Okay?
So then the unit embedding it becomes a kind of universal arrow.
Yes, so it is a kind of a universal arrow. And in what sense? In the sense of being, so that's what I was trying to say, in the sense of co-limit, free co-completion, right? So that's why, so it's a co-limit completion or the free co-completion, right? So in this sense it is said to be the free co-completion of A.
What motivates this this terminology of free? What motivates it?
Because there is no specific restriction. Whatever small co-complete category may you take, any functor, it goes over there.
Yeah.
It's whatever, so there is. But the only thing is, it should be small,
yeah.
Right? Small co-complete, right? So, whatever small co-complete category may you take, it extends to that.
Mm.
So, in that sense, the extension has no bound, no preconditions set on it. So in that sense, it's the free co-completion. All possible, so you have this category A, and you think of all possible co-limits that you can take out of A.
Mm.
So taking sums, taking quotients of those sums, sums and quotients, further sums of them, their quotients, right? And in all possible ways that you might do it, so the smallest category where you can put all of them together is the category of pre-sheaves. Okay? So that's the best place where you can think of it. Of all possible ways of taking co-limits of the objects and whatever you had, information you had in here. Okay? That's there. It is one more wonder that this functor preserves F bar preserves co-limits. So you take a sum over here, it goes to the sum here. Right? And in fact, this follows from the fact that this functor has a right adjoint. So you see, it's quite deep, right? It's very, very deep what this Yonadar gives us. Okay? There's one more thing about this. Yonadar preserves limits. And the third thing is
what are limits? Well, it will be again iteration of products and equalizers. So you take products, equalizers means kind of taking some kind of subspaces, nice subspaces, right? Products, subspaces, their products, subspaces, and all possible ways of combinations of this, right? Yoneda preserves that. So Yoneda is not only producing a free co-completion, but a limit-preserving one. A limit-preserving free co-completion. Okay?
Mm-hmm.
And this gives us a big, and I will actually show this. In fact, Bosso goes quite far in this approach. If you are trying to think of any limiting process in a category, think of it in sex. Okay? Think of it in sex first. If you can get a feeling of that, well, that will exist in it. You can formalize it in a category. Okay? So, how to think of limits? Think of it in terms of sex. Co-limits is a big, big issue. You have to be careful there. Okay? But the whole procedure of taking limits, that means monomorphisms, taking products, taking equalizers, okay, all these processes, you can just simply replace your category by sets and try and visualize what is it that is going on. You'll get a picture of what is happening. Okay? And this is done by Yoneda. Okay? So it actually provides a viewing window for the category theorist. We know sets, okay? How do I, so why will you say, what is it that you, okay, so let's see. Often you will see that, why do I want to go beyond sets, if you might ask this question. You know pretty well that just as groups,
what it is, a wind.
Just as groups are interesting,
uh-huh,
topological groups are also equally interesting.
Uh-huh.
Okay, and what are topological groups? They are group objects in the category of topological spaces. And they play, you know, big role in mathematics, right? The study of topological groups regular topological groups and so on. Okay. But what are these topological groups? They are group objects in the category of topological spaces. So it is not quite out of the context to start thinking just beyond sets. But how do we do it? Sets give us a big guiding picture. Okay? How should I start to think? And that's where that sets really gives us the guiding picture to generalize it to some other context, right? Is actually the essence of Yoneda's level. Yoneda's embedding. Okay? So you see, it actually produces a whole string of of results and of serious implications as far as the viewpoint of a category theorist is concerned. Okay? So it is in fact a very, very significant result. Okay?
So is your question answered?
Yeah, no,
modulo all of this. Yes.
No, but the thing, okay, every time that I read and you explain, I get a better understanding, but I don't think I've reached the full understanding. But every time that I read and you explain, yeah, it gets clear and clear.
Thank you, but supposedly it will get better and better. Okay. Now, we came up with the notion of last time with the notion of a representable functor, right? So, if you remember, so F is representable so if and only if there exists an object, then there exists a natural isomorphism. Natural isomorphism right? And this was this so this is a natural isomorphism. So this got replaced by using Yoneda by saying there exists an object, there exists an A in F of A, because alpha X is going to, yeah, such that for all objects X, for all t in f of x, or you said x possibly, yeah, x in f of x, there exists a unique morphism such that this x is alpha x of f, right? But that is f dot a is equal to x, right? Okay, so that was the condition for representability, which we arrived at. Okay, good. So I'm going to now show that, well, suppose F is representable. No, I'll not do it in this way. Let's start with that thing that we said that, and A, you have, there is A eta is the universal morphism from A to U. This we saw was saying that A eta is the initial object of this coma category. Yeah? Okay. And this, all of this actually meant is there was, you have this, I want for an object A, sorry, let's take this A bar, yeah, so U of A bar, right? A bar must be here.
Yeah.
And this is eta. And if you have B, then you have a unique morphism UF bar, which makes this comment, right?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Now, so this actually tells us that if you look into two this map, okay? This is an isomorphism. Okay?
Mm-hmm.
And it is natural in B. Yeah?
Okay.
Clear?
Yeah.
So,
what is it?
I have this functor from B to sets. How is it defined? Okay. Which I said I'll be writing as home AU dash or something like that. Yeah? So, the existence of, so the existence.
See, just copy the, in that you confuse in the sense that this U is from A, B to A, and that U, the next U, this one.
Yes? What are you doing? You are
taking
from B to A. This is U.
Okay, okay, that is set as in home set, okay. Yeah. Mm-hmm.
And then you are taking home, composing it with this representable functor.
Mm-hmm.
This is your F. Right?
Yeah. Okay.
Okay. So what you are saying is that A bar eta is the universal morphism from A to U, if and only if the functor is representable. Yeah? We have seen one side. We have seen one side. If we have seen this side, if this happens, this turns out to be representable.
Yeah.
With representable and is represented by A bar. Remember, if a functor is representable, the object whose home functor represents it, that was the representation, right?
Yeah.
And how does eta come up? How does eta come up over here? Well, how do I get hold of eta? Eta, so if you take the identity map, if you take a bar over here, if you take this to be your a bar, And if you take this to be your eta again, then this map has to be the identity map. Right? So, if you take, so a bar to a bar, if you take the identity map over here, alright? So, if you take your identity map, the since this is a bijection, so in place of B, if you take theta a bar, the map which is taken by theta a bar to the identity map is this eta, right? So, eta is actually theta a bar inverse of the identity of a bar. Right? Clear? That's what I see over here. Okay. So, that's, so now I'm saying that this is the other version of so let's prove this. This is already seen. Okay? So let's see. Suppose if it's like this. So that means I'm saying Hom is representable. And is represented by a bar. Okay? So, there exists from Hom a bar x to Hom a u x. Okay? So, what would it be? So, if I take a map over here F, now let me say G. So, this is the thing. So, you have to take the action of this on this, right? So this turns out to be you first take UG. Okay, I'm getting a little fast. So the representability, let's go back to this. So I know that there exists an A bar. There exists an A, I said. There exists an A, so this, right? So, shall I copy this? Let me copy it here. So, this is the criterion for representability, right? Okay. So this A is actually A bar. Okay? So this fact is telling me, therefore, there exists an A in F of A bar such that for all X in because F is from B, right? For all x in f of x, there exists a unique f dot a is x. Okay? That is happening. So let's see, what does this mean? F of a bar, what is it? There exists an a from Hom a to U of A bar. Okay? Such that for all x in B naught, for all x in Hom A of UX. There exists a unique F from A to X. Ah, sorry. This A should be A bar here. This was the same. Yeah. So there exists a unique, this says that. Remember, what was this? This was F of F at A, right?
Mm-hmm.
So I'm still writing it like this. So let me write this as X is F of F evaluated at A, right?
Mm-hmm.
But what is F? F is HOM A UF evaluated at A, right?
Mm-hmm.
So this is nothing else but A composed UF composed. Okay, let's see what I am saying. So this means that there exists an A from such that for all objects from here, from all X, here, there exists a unique morphism here, such that UF composed A is X. Okay? So this is actually saying the same thing as A bar A is the universal morphism. From A to U. Yeah? So what did we come up with? We came up with this fact. So this is a theorem. Given. Okay. And now this gives us, therefore, another way of looking into universality. And historically speaking, this has been the style. In American schools, people, MacLean and others, they would define things in terms of, they would mean by universality something like on the left hand side, that diagram. There exists a unique system, yeah? Whereas, in the French school, they were much more comfortable with saying the fact that, well, I have a representative object. There's a functor which is represented. Okay? The fact is, they are actually saying the same thing. Okay? They're actually saying the same thing. But these were two different approaches, which went on and on. But you can see that it is the advent of category theory only, we could come and see that they're actually the same thing. There's the two sides of the same coin. Okay?
Mm-hmm.
So we'll utilize this in several next examples. Okay?
Mm-hmm.
So, the right-hand side is representability of a suitable functor. So, whenever you are saying that some functor is representable, you are actually giving an universal construction. And vice versa,
Whenever you are giving me an universal construction, you are actually giving a suitable pointer and a representation of it. Okay? So, you can do it in any one of these two ways. So now, for the next part, we would look into several examples. And we would look into these two kinds of definitions. So we would once approach an example from the universal side, as well as approach it from the representability side. Okay? We would be using both in our calculations, in our computations, since they are equivalent. We would actually be using any one of them, possibly even mixtures of this. Sometimes by universality. So now, we should not have any hard and fast, exclusions, right? We can use any one of them, whichever suits us. Okay? All right. Now, so first, let's look into co-products. Shakatumba will say, why not products?
That's okay, I have understood. But I think, when a person, okay, like a learner, when they're reading, they will expect to start from product and then co. All right, leave it and then co. But I understand, funny, like the other time you say that it's not a matter of difficulties, it's just.
So it's just, why should you think that this is more natural than the other one?
Because it's shorter. The name is shorter than. His name product is shorter.
You've just deleted it to make it, so. Okay. Yes, there's also another reason why I selected. Apart from the fact that it will nothing to do with op, but there's another reason also. Products are very well understood, right? But we'll have to give a little more emphasis on these co-limits kind of things. Okay. And we have to be careful. Not at this stage, but in general. Now, let's think of sets. Taking products is there in the axiom that given any two small sets A and B, there exists a set which contains that ordered pair A. An ordered pair is also defined as a set and so on. And then you can define the Cartesian product by extensionality principle and so on. Okay. But taking products is fine. It is kind of saying as if I have one type of thing, another type of thing, I want to merge them into. Yeah? But suppose I want to not merge them into a single type, a single form. AB is another set, right? Separate from A and B. The ordered pair AB is a third set, right? But I don't want to change. I want to keep it, keep those things. And I want to just put it, kind of union, right? I want to take a union. But union has a problem. Things which are repeating, which is in the intersection, they don't get repeated. They get merged. So what is happening? Things which are, what are these common things? Well, these common things appear as two kinds, right? It appears as a type of A as well as a type of B, right? And so when I take an union, they just vanish. Okay, so it's again something. Yes, kind of loss of information. So I want to maintain and I want to keep its identity also, right?
Mm-hmm.
So, therefore, comes in sets. This strange object, what is it? A is a small set.
Mm-hmm.
So I can have this set. Singleton A
mm-hmm.
is a set. Right?
Okay.
Okay. One nicety about this, if you look into its elements, firstly, even if A and B have something in common, these two sets cannot have anything in common. Because it is a way to disjointify it.
Yeah.
Because this set A cross singleton A is in bijective correspondence with the set A. Okay? But its types have actually changed in the fact that as if the second component is telling me it's from where do these elements come from. Okay? So its elements look like XA. Okay? And these elements look like XB. And if an element X is common to both A and B, here it comes with the second coordinate A. So it just tells me it is coming from A.
Mm-hmm.
So it is not same as this. So these two are disjoint. Okay?
Mm-hmm.
These two are disjoint. So this
is
all.
No other symbol for disjoint union.
I use plus.
Okay. Inside the union.
Oh, inside the union.
No, like plus like that.
No. When you're using that one, the union.
Yeah.
Don't they sometimes put a something?
A dot.
Like a square union.
Ah, yes, yes.
You know,
maybe sometimes they use it. Yeah.
Even in the book, right?
Yeah, I think that's.
Yeah.
Yeah, I think.
Like some kind of. Like a union with sharp corners. Instead of the round, like
then,
this one.
Ah, okay. Yes. But I kind of prefer this plus.
This okay.
I use plus instead of that. Yeah, many people use that inverted pi, capital pi.
Yeah.
I somehow like to use this plus. Okay. So, what about it? Remember, we are the stark difference between sets, and when we go out, or shouldn't say, when we try to think categorically, is we'll have to eliminate elements. So we have to think in terms of maps.
So, over here, obviously, we have two nice maps. Why do I take this? What does iota 1 do? It takes x to xa and it takes y to yb. Okay?
The moment I have this, comes in the next story.
So, I have a set. I was given these two sets.
Mm-hmm.
I have a set and two maps. So the question is this universal? So I have two maps going into this thing. Well, immediately I know that there exists a unique map. And what does F2? It takes XA to F1X and it takes XB to F2X. So it's this unique map, and I'll from now on I'll represent this F as this column. Okay?
Mm-hmm.
So F is the unique map such that F iota 1 is F1 and F iota 2 is F2. Okay?
Okay.
So this sum become a kind of universal object.
Mm-hmm.
Okay?
Yeah.
Good. So that's this universal side story. What about, so this tells me HOM A plus B to X. From here, I can see I take it to F iota 1 and F iota 2. Okay? Alright?
Yes.
Now you observe that this is a bijection.
Okay.
This is a bijection natural. So it is actually telling me that this functor, so what is my functor? This functor is taking X to HOM AX cross AX. Yeah? This functor, so the sum, this functor is representable, okay?
Mm-hmm.
And it is represented by the sum A plus B, okay? So F is representable and is represented by the sum.
Professor, where is this F coming from?
What?
This big F.
Yeah, I am defining that functor.
Yeah.
In this case, it's a product.
Yeah,
it's
a object. This is a set. This is a set.
Yeah.
Right? Clear?
Yeah.
So, we can now export this to any category. So, in a category A, given these objects A and B, we shall say that the coproduct of A and B exists if the functor so this is again composition with F cross composition. Yeah? Mm-hmm. Is represented.
And
the representing object is the coproduct.
Going back through those, all of that representation, let's do it over here in general, right? Let's do it. So what does this mean? What does this mean? It's representable. Again, let's go back to this, little thing. Sorry.
Let's go back to this representable, this little thing. Okay?
Mm-hmm.
So let's see. So I'm saying it is getting represented by this. That means I'm going to say that there exists an A in F of A plus B, says that for all X in A naught, for all X in F of X, there exists a unique morphism. Says that F dot A is equal to X, right?
Mm-hmm.
Let's see. So, this means, what is F of A cross B? There exists an A belonging to HOM. A to A plus B cross HOM. A to A plus B, right? Such that for all X in A naught, for all X in HOM, A to X, cross HOM, B to X, there exists a unique such that F of F at A, this is X, right? But I know from here that therefore A looks like some iota 1 and iota 2, where iota 1 is from A to A plus B. Iota 2 is from B to A plus B. This X looks like some X1 and X2. Right?
Mm-hmm.
And this is, what is this? This is, remember, this is this composed F.
Mm-hmm.
Cross this composed F. Right?
Mm-hmm.
At iota 1 and iota 2. This is X1 and X2. So this is, I'm saying, iota 1 composed F is X1 and iota 2 composed F is X2, right?
Mm-hmm.
So which is saying that there exists actually two morphisms such that for every object X, and morphisms there exists a unique F F composed, sorry, I made this mistake. F composed, yeah, sorry, F, so this was F composed iota 1. And this is F. Okay.
So that's why we put it in this way. What's a co-product? It's a triplet. That object and these two morphisms, iota 1 and iota 2, with this universal property. Okay?
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
So now you know always this, you see over here, this is, okay.
Let's look at it now at another way. Is I am going to say that you take this 2-point discrete, so suppose another look.
There's 7 pages. There's 6 pages.
Ah, yes. 6 pages. Thanks. So let me change this.